This is a panel we did in Munich, and we were an enormous hit in Munich.
We were voted the best panel.
We are the best
panel. I think that's because we were all women.
So here's the deal. First of all...
So your challenge...
It's great.
...to make sure we're there this time, right?
Okay.
Two things. For women, we actually count for 16 women, I think, at this point. And then secondly, we do not lack confidence and self-esteem. And so we are going to talk about a lot of things, but what we did replace, is not Hillary Rosen, although she could be your sister, I guess. Hillary Rosen was kept in Washington. And this is Carolyn Ryan from the New York Times, who's an astonishing editor. She's on the masthead. She's super powerful. The New York Times has done some of the best political coverage, I think the best political coverage that's been going on. Sorry, Megan.
Yeah. Sorry, Megan.
We were going to talk about a lot of things. When we started off in Munich, I'm going to start with these two, if you don't mind, Carolyn.
Okay.
We said, we don't know what the fuck is going on in the United States. And we're so sorry, Germany, France, and the rest of the world. So let's start from there. How do we feel today, Megan?
So we still don't know what the fuck is going on.
All right.
In fact, we know even less about what the fuck is going on, given what's happened this week, a perfect example. Look, I think there's been some very interesting... Who was in Munich? Were any of these people? Okay. So I think there's been some really interesting... One thing I think is the biggest takeaway, and I was thinking about this morning, is that are we at the point where a bold experiment with fundamental disruption of, you know, establishment politics, foundational, what we assume and think the norms of politics are, whether that bold experiment with Trump and what we've seen to some extent in France, to some extent with the decimation of labor in the UK, has already failed. Like, are we already seeing the tail end of what was a massive push and moment of time of both, obviously, people who wanted change and wanted to sort of smash the system up? Are we already seeing people now saying, I wanted to smash it up, but actually the results of that are so much worse than I expected them to be, whether it's Brexit, whether it's just the Trump administration's sort of failure to project a sense of organization, organized politics, a policy framework, et cetera. So that's one thing I wonder if we're at,
a buyer's remorse kind of thing.
Buyer's remorse, but more if this moment is going to be compressed into such a more temporary phenomenon in terms of this surge of economic populism and nativism, simply because people look at what the result is on both sides of the Atlantic and they're saying to themselves, I'm not so sure I wanted that already, and it's only been 110
10 days.
I think what we're seeing in the U.S., you be global, I'll be U.S., you can be whatever you want. You're the New York Times, for God's sake. Okay. But I think what we're seeing out of this White House is a systematic breakdown of every single, or trying to break down every single institution, right? So we started with media during the campaign, right? And government, law enforcement. Now, what we're seeing with the firing of the FBI director and the way it was done is, wait a minute, you guys are not on my side. If you look at the messaging from the White House, every story said, well, the president didn't think he was in his corner. Well, the FBI director is not supposed to be in your corner. But by giving these comments, he's bringing down one of the institutions, one of the final institutions left in America that people respect. You know, there used to be a show, the FBI. Do you guys remember the FBI? The FBI in color. As a longtime cable news...
Did you say in color?
In color. That's what they used to say. The FBI in color. Ephraim Zimbalist Jr. But the whole point is, it was an institution like the Catholic Church, so respected.
Like the Catholic Church.
No, don't
you're
care. Saying,
you're
what
killing
in
my
God's
story.
Name.
That, no, but I'm. But that's
not
an respected. Important story.
You know what? She did not see
fact.
Spotlight. But go ahead.
Yes, I'm just trying to get you into TV, guys.
Right,
TV is not over. It's still happening.
So,
but the point is, Americans, I'm talking about Americans, respected the FBI. They used to respect the Catholic Church. People would change their channel. Oh, it's someone from the FBI. They're a truth teller, okay? So they've taken Congress, every single institution. This is the last one left. So the truth, you know, if they have this independent counsel people are talking about, or special prosecutor, call it what you want, will the American people, will people around the world respect that decision? That's what the game is, okay? It's not just that he's gone. It's just we don't have to respect anything else that happens. It's all messy. Not quite sure. Hillary Clinton, just mess it all up, and then you can do what you want.
All right, Carolyn, I call this right now a Trumpster fire. But the concept of what's going on right now, I have this sneaking suspicion it's working, actually, a lot of this chaos. I come from Silicon Valley. Chaos is something they love, disruption, destruction. Talk a little bit about what it's like to cover it, because you all weigh in with facts and facts and facts, and it seems like it just piles on each other. The lies continue to pile, and none of them count.
Well, I would say that this moment feels appreciably different from most Trumpster fires. I do think that the chaos was actually calming down a little bit. Mm-hmm. But, you know, journalistically, it's been pretty extraordinary. I'm sure you saw there was a great Washington Post story that broke last night, sort of a reconstruction of how this all came apart. Mm-hmm. 30 sources. Yep. And that's partly because it's the leakiest White House we've ever seen in modern times, but it's partly because there are so many factions and there's so much misinformation, and it's almost sort of like gamesmanship that you need solid, voluminous information gathered almost in a mountainous way to cover this. I would just say two things responding to you folks. First of all, for Donald Trump, remember, here in New York, we know him. For 45 years, this guy has not had a boss, has not had a board of directors, has not really had investors, has had partners, but tends to kind of screw them or things come apart. So he's accustomed to acting unilaterally, and he's accustomed to this kind of behavior, and we're all seeing it in real time as president, and we're not at all accustomed to it. I mean, you saw the extraordinary reality after he fired Comey. His own team didn't even have a consistent message. And I had another thought, but it just... poof.
So do you consider, how do you look at the first 100 days? Because it does feel like an onslaught of like things you forget he did last week, which
right.
were outrageous. And so what happens, it seems like, I was listening on the way in on my 9-hour drive here from JFK. I was listening to MSNBC, and the driver and I were in hysterics because the lying was just, it wasn't even like, they were going Nixonian. I'm like, Nixon like covered up his lies, but these are like lies. And then they're like, oh no, what we really meant was, and what we really meant. It feels a little bit like covering Uber for me. But what? Talk about that idea of when you're covering this as a reporter, like Maggie Haberman.
Right.
How do you not go, oh my God, stop? Like what is?
No,
like,
it's relentless.
It's a persistent and out. Just out in the open lie, just an appreciably checkable, easy lie.
Right, and it's almost adolescent in the sense of it's coming apart in real time. You just got home too late and your parents are quizzing you and the first story kind of falls apart. I mean, it was pretty quick yesterday
yes.
to see the Deputy Attorney General, that first narrative just kind of dissolve.
Yeah.
And now they're not even embracing it anymore. There's not a pretense that we started out with the truth. So one thing that you'll probably notice, those of you who follow our reporters on Twitter, they're very kind of unrelenting about pointing out inconsistencies, and they have to kind of keep on it. Like she was going until midnight last night, just pointing out.
Maggie was.
Yes. Yeah. And very high in our stories, we have to say that does not correspond, that's incongruous with the facts.
Right.
And you know,
so, but the
so do you? I want to talk about that. Do you spend your time doing that? Like,
yes.
Oh, do you seem like sort of the nerdy kid? Like, that's a lie. That's
okay,
a lie.
So,
that's a lie.
So let's just talk about the flip side of what Caroline's talking about is the incessant untruths that come out. So, but yet they call to correct whether Sean Spicer was standing in the bushes or amid the bushes giving the breakdown as this is all. So there's also a microscopic level of personal, the most thin-skinned White House I think we've seen as well in the cut and the thrust and control. But just on the flip side of that, what Caroline is saying about let's call them untruths or lies. The first story yesterday was that the Deputy Attorney General, of his own volition, had taken upon himself to look in whether or not James Comey should stay as an FBI director, and then came up with this memo saying that because of how Hillary Clinton's email server was handled, you know, he had made fundamental breaks, then committed the word atrocities was being thrown around. And then they were like, that story actually totally doesn't fly or make any sense. So let's come up with a completely alternative narrative. And then they release a TikTok. I mean, it is actually, it is so hard for journalists. I know I said this in Munich because we talked about this during the campaign a lot as well. It is hard for our profession to really even keep on getting ahead of it and correct all the inaccuracies. There's so many things I actually think that get not enough attention because there's just so much misinformation.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I feel like sometimes, and maybe Tim, you can talk about this, you're being dragged into a telenovela that you are not in control of. Like, and so it's, what is going to do this week? You know, what's the thing that's going to happen? I'm feeling like a divorce is happening, or a separation with Melania will be next week, and we'll be like, oh, wow, that, something like crazy like that.
Well, I guess we really shouldn't be surprised by that, because his greatest success was on television. I just think it's ironic that The Apprentice, you know, his great line was, you're fired. He didn't fire. He had some nameless, faceless guy do it, right? Mm-hmm. America voted for him because they thought he'd get in there and make some solid decisions. But at every point like this, he doesn't want
to
be on the front line.
He moves to drama. He moves to some dramatic.
Right, but he's not the front guy. He's like, hey, look at my squad. I think it's fascinating that we're on the pool reports and we get these, you know, this information every day about what the president has planned, or the vice president. And the vice president, it always says that he's listening. So the president has to have the vice president listening. And of course, the other big story this week, really, about this whole thing is that the vice president got thrust out there yesterday, and he's defending all of this. So there's many, many Republicans who originally thought, well, hey, if the, you know, President Trump fails, at least we've got, you know, Pence there. He's one of us, even though he's really conservative. You know, but he'll be, but he's complicit in all of this.
Well, complicit is, I think, the word.
Just a quick echo of that. The one metric to look at, in our package today, we have detailed graphic on how Republicans and Democrats are responding to this. And if you look at Republicans, 77 of them either were neutral or voiced support for this. So watch those people and watch other Republicans in the weeks to come, especially as the stories fall apart and especially as the journalism.
Well, let's talk about that. The idea of two things I want to talk about is the Republican support, which seems to be firm. Like, as usual, Paul Ryan is spineless.
Mitch McConnell.
Exactly.
And there was not a broad embrace for some kind of independent investigation.
Right.
So
how much longer, first of all, before you get into what he's actually passing, how successful from a policy point of view is this administration? For all the noise and Sturm und Drang, is there a successful path here for policies that these people can pass that they like? Is there?
No, I mean, this is the real worry. With the isolation comes a diminishment of the agenda. I mean, I'm obsessed with tax policy and what's going to happen, and, you know, all the sort of hoo-ha that they offered about how they were going to overhaul the tax policy. I mean, are they even going to be able to get a hearing on such a thing? Are they even going to be able to move more modest legislation? You know what happens when a leader gets isolated. And if you saw the Q poll yesterday, if those numbers hold, I mean, he was down to 36. And the one thing that other politicians are obsessed with is their own self-preservation. And so if they start to see him crumble, they're going to think about their own seat.
You don't see that, right?
Watch the market as well. Watch the market, because so much of the expectation has been tax. So, mm-hmm. you know, tax and deregulation. That's what, you know, so many of his policies, as we've talked about before, disproportionately benefit not just the 1%, but the 0.0001%. And they have seen tremendous wealth gains already through the market, through the rebound, through the continuing strength, which I think has surprised many observers. But if, you know, there is the few people showed him at 36, there's also, we've seen odds now drifting up of people who actually think he's going to make it through his first term has gone up to almost a 50-50 bet on some of the Wall Street shops. So what we're going to see too is that market confidence going to ebb away as people get more and more skeptical that he's going to be able to pass any comprehensive policy framework, whether it's tax, whether it's infrastructure booth, whether it actually is deregulation form of stripping away Dodd-Frank. But the flip side of that is we've got unemployment. Initial claims just came out this morning. They are at a record low. Not a record low, but they're the lowest in 28 years. You know, he has inherited such a tailwind on economic growth and a strengthening economy, a tightening labor market, which means that wages will go up and that he will see the gains from that. So he inherited an economy in a position to take off. He's going to continue to be buffeted by that. So whether or not he'll be able to sort of still maintain any kind of momentum to get something through, they are so desperate, Republicans, for an overhaul of tax reform. I think Caroline is exactly right that tax is the one thing to really watch.
Kara, the question you're asking is, has it affected people's lives? And
right.
I would argue they have had such an effect already, whether you're talking about EPA policies and coal ash. You tell the people in West Virginia, look at the mountaintop mining, look at all those issues, look at healthcare. People don't know what's going to happen. They don't know what they don't know if they're going to die. They don't know if they're going to keep. They don't know. Businesses don't know what they have to pay. I think this is the biggest change we've ever seen in all the primary issues that affect everyone's life. And people are scared to death. You may not be an immigrant. You'll know an immigrant. You never know what's going to happen. You never know if they're going to change the policy a little. What is the court going to decide? Is he going to attack a judge? So this is, you know, all hands on deck. Everyone has to be ready every day. You wake up in the morning and you think, what are they going to do next? Like today, there's another executive order coming out.
Yeah.
While we're, you know, to change the conversation. So I think people's lives have dramatically changed more than any other administration.
Do you think that? Regular
people's lives?
Regular people's lives.
Immigration, I think, is a very good issue because it's a big deal in Silicon Valley. But I met with someone yesterday at something called College Track. This woman who has been, she was being affected by DACA. She's been in this country 27 years. She contributes mightily to the economy. She's working on water and nutrition issues for poor people in San Mateo. She doesn't know if she's staying in this country for 2 years. She's literally been here for 27 years.
Well, I mean, I think that really captures what I feel like the biggest change in terms of regular people is the uncertainty.
Right.
In that sort of sense of what is going to happen. And I would say one thing, you talked about the shattering of the institutions and the protocols. I'm an optimist, but I sort of feel like one thing we've seen in this Trump moment is the durability of some of our institutions, especially the judiciary on issues like immigration. And the durability of the judiciary, the media has been, you know, aggressive and zealous. Not so sure about the legislative branch, but we'll see. But I feel like in some ways the Trump moment might end up reinforcing the values that we actually hold dear in this democracy.
Oh, so he's good for us.
He's
good for us?
But I think that there might be a way that it affirms the things that people care about. I mean, you have people marching in the streets over immigration, civil liberties,
women's
rights.
But let's talk about the flip side of that. So the cover story of Business Week this week, I'm not plugging it, but it's talking about a town in Kansas, Olathe, Kansas, which has attracted Garmin, other, like a town you probably, most people have never heard of, 30 miles outside Kansas City. It was where two Garmin engineers were shot by someone who yelled and shot them saying, get out of my country, one of whom died, one of whom was injured. And it tells the story of how this town, which is actually 8% Indian American, has Sikh temples, has a Hindu temple, has grown up as a model of the socioeconomic kind of cultural melting pot that we believe is the best of American values. Quickest job growth, has people, cricket leagues, is one of the most diverse communities, and how this incident, of this nativist rhetoric really threatens the fabric of society. So I agree with you, while it is possible that we'll see people, push for the values that they hold dear in the communities that, this is America's America. This isn't Trump's America. And people feel scared and they feel uncertain and they're looking over their shoulder now for a time they never had before.
Right.
And people from, New Delhi are now being confused with ISIS potential suspects. And that's the danger that if this rhetoric isn't corrected, that those communities will really come under threat.
You saw a situation in France where everybody was terrified by Marie. She did not win. Largely because she stepped all over. I mean, she seemed to have really gone insane in the last parts. In a way, Trump did, but it didn't work in France.
But remember, in France, 50% in the first round was either for the far left or the far right. Mélenchon and Le Pen attracted 50% of the first round votes. I mean, that's the thing, I think, what I was talking about at the beginning is, are we at a moment where this, this movement towards both radical extremes of the spectrum is ephemeral, or whether it's lasting? I'm not sure that just Marine Le Pen, who had such extreme views, still see strongman rulers in Indonesia. We see, we've seen it, we've seen it lose in the Netherlands, we've seen it lose in France now, but we see strongmen emerging in Latin America, in Asia, and, we see it obviously in North Korea. I think it's just something that is, there is a moment right now of strongman politics. Trump is one of them. Putin, obviously Erdogan in Turkey, and it's something to really watch whether or not this is lasting.
But I think both in France and the United States, is there an effort and a focus on addressing the issues that gave rise to Trump? And I feel like I really worry about France because it feels like they essentially embrace somebody who doesn't seem to have the experience and the emotional capacity to really bond with those people.
So let's talk about the response, the Democrats. We've talked a little bit about Trump, but where do you see the Democratic response now? Tammy, why don't you start?
I think they're trying, but I think in a day where everyone was waiting to see what they could do, let's all meet on the Senate chamber, right? That doesn't work. That atmosphere, you're better off protesting in front of the White House. Or they just haven't organized a complete plan. The other thing is, remember that President Trump called Lindsey Graham, a Republican senator, called Dianne Feinstein, a Democratic senator, who was the third person he called? Schumer, to tell them about the firing, right? So they had slightly muted responses, so maybe there's something else going on, but if you're just talking about how people look at it, they have not organized a good response. You've got Hillary Clinton putting together a super PAC. What does that mean? Bernie Sanders sounds like he's saying the same thing. Elizabeth Warren shaking her head. These are really effective, great Democratic players, but they're not getting anywhere.
Well, here's
right?
the problem. Yeah. If you lose close to 1,000 seats nationwide and your party almost gets wiped out, I mean, they can't even hold a hearing.
Right.
They don't run one committee. I mean, here's what's worrisome for the Democrats. All this mishigas on the Republican side is going to eclipse and distract from the fact that they have a lot of problems.
Right.
And they don't have a leader. And it feels like there's a little bit of a way that let's face it, Trump, even if you think he's despicable, the story is mesmerizing. But don't forget that Democrats are really adrift. And it feels like a moment where they have to decide what they stand for. Are they a cultural party? Are they an economic party? And sort of what is the future?
Who do you see pulling out? Anybody? Do you see any hopes of anything? Because it seems like just this week, with Comey, they've got to do the most incredible pretzel on that. Like, we hate him, but not, we hate the way he was fired, but we hate him. But we hate the way, and it was like, what? Like, you know what I mean?
It was really interesting acrobatics.
It was fantastic. And of course, Trump was like, I liked him, but I hate him. But the whole thing was sort of fascinating.
Right. I mean, we'll probably have not to get ahead of ourselves, but I do obsess about this. We're probably going to have the biggest field in about 40 years of Democratic candidates. It's coming, Megan. And,
it's not
coming. Even in this region, we're going to have likely Cory Booker, Kirsten Gillibrand, Andrew Cuomo clearly wants to run.
We're all about 2020 here. No, we start with Mark Zuckerberg. Am I right?
No.
This room starts with Mark
Zuckerberg. He's not running.
So
I know. He had fun in Ohio.
He's not running. He's petting livestock. That's what he's doing.
All right.
So here's the thing, though. Look at these names. Andrew Cuomo, Cory Booker, Kirsten Gillibrand, Kamala Harris, Amy Klobuchar. Really? Like, really? Is that what people think is going to break through in the kind of environment that we face right now? I mean, this is the thing about the Democratic Party, and you guys know it is one of my favorite topics. It is mind-blowing, and it is exactly what you're saying. It is mind-blowing to me that in this moment, they have been so unable to seize any sort of national moment. The party, the DNC, is still in complete disarray. They're literally being driven by, people on the streets are more effective in their local communities and raising opposition to the kind of policies they see than the party, and the inability of them to push forward a unified national message on two fronts. Yes, they need to push forward with their resist message. It's gaining traction. They also need to come forward with a positive message of economic growth and raising your families up. It is crazy.
Is there an opening for a Marcon-like? I mean, he was there a year. He was in France. 1 year he was.
Well, he was on the beach.
Right, he was on the beach, yeah.
I do think that Trump has changed the equation I used to believe that Americans had certain notions and qualities and characteristics they saw in a president and they expected from a president, and Trump didn't fit that. And I feel like he shattered that. So I think any Democrat or CEO or progressive or activist who's ever thought, maybe I should be president, there's not going to be that threshold. People are going to jump in. So I think whatever the definition, it's going to be more expansive. And I would think, you're going to have people like
Bob Iger, Howard Schultz.
Yes.
Howard Schultz and others.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think it's The Rock. I've already predicted this.
No, laugh as you much as you want.
The Rock is actually
legitimate. And by the way, since we last met, his movie's number one around the world. Okay? I'm just saying.
Which movie is that? Fast and Furious?
Fast and Furious.
Oh, right. And Baywatch is coming. So we're
all
together.
And Baywatch in a week.
First of all, if it's The Rock v. Trump, I'm so back on that campaign. That is That is a dream come true.
So well, but to your point, in a serious way, to your point, it's what did Barack Obama do? He had a positive message. He came out of the blue, similar chaos, not quite exactly the same, and he had this positive message, and everyone jumped in. And I do think that, you know, talking about The Rock, it's the same kind of positive message, inclusive. You know, you can be from anywhere and achieve anything. Look at me. Look at all the people I help. He's got a show. He's got a music show on.
All right. Okay. See you.
CNN.
Tammy's in the tank for The Rock.
And you can sign up for the campaign when you.
And his,
no, but the point is.
And he is impeccable as in.
And
pecs.
He is impeccable
as in pecs.
Right.
Right.
You should get him for code.
You think?
Definitely.
You know, I
it may be someone that we not met. You know, right. It could be.
So no, but it's positive message, and we're not seeing that from the Democrats. Exactly. And it kind of reminds me of the Labor Party, right? Where they ended up with
Jeremy
Corbyn.
Don't get me started on
sorry,
that.
Sorry.
Don't get me started.
Well, let's not go into the UK right now, but let's finish up by predictions, because we only have just a few
minutes
left.
Since we've proven to be so prescient about
right, prescient.
Everything.
Okay. What do you think is, what do you think the thing in 1 year we'll be talking about? Because we're going to be in Munich. You're coming to Munich now, Carolyn. Ausgezeichnet.
In 1 year, what will we be talking about? We'll already be talking about the congressional elections and how many seats Donald Trump, if he's still president, and I think he will be, will lose in those elections. I mean, you're already seeing people like Joni Ernst start to distance herself from him. You're going to likely see more Republicans do that. That's why I say keep an eye on those 77 people. Does this person become, it's like a Melville novel, like does he become a leader who's so isolated that he's essentially ineffectual and we almost have like a ruling congressional force?
Okay, Tammy?
Well, I think it is all about 2018, but the question is will President Trump help the Republicans? Does he hurt them? And what supports some of the leaders we've talked about, potential people that are running in 2020, are they going to jump in and help? That'll really inform 2020. So if you see, you know, if you see Kirsten Gillibrand catch a wave or Amy Klobuchar catch a wave, I mean, I actually think
I would pay to see Amy Klobuchar catch a wave.
Yeah.
They're definitely bigger players.
No. But they're going to get in there and then they're going to prove themselves within the party and they'll get lifted up by the Democratic machine.
All right.
I agree in that. I think I don't think it'll be either of those two people, but I think next year at this time we'll be talking about consolidation behind a Democrat that I think is either going to be out of the tech field or going to be out of a business environment and the surge that they're getting. And because people like me just keep banging on about it, they will hopefully have formed a more cohesive policy about how to address, you know, inequality, reform of the sort of, you know, institutional reform, how they can make people's lives better, and they will be.
May I ask you, which of those tech leaders do you think that?
Yeah,
would be?
Who do you think? Because you should say it now.
I don't know. I don't want to say.
Guess Trump.
I don't want to say.
Go ahead. Yes, you do.
I don't know.
Yeah,
you
come on.
I think Cheryl. I think Cheryl still.
Come on.
I think Cheryl still. Yeah. Who knows?
She will not run.
I know.
Cheryl Sandberg
will not run. I'm going to make that. I'm going to go again.
I know. I think I'm not saying just from tech. I'm saying from
tech. We only have
business.
One of her.
Tech or business. So.
Right. But you know, honestly, this book that she has, I don't know if you've read it or seen it, is a remarkable gift to anyone who's been through any sort of tragedy. We all have, no matter what it is.
It's a big gift. It's really great. All right. Very last thing. Any legislation that'll pass? What's the next piece of legislation that will pass?
No, I'm really worried about, you know, the tax bill in particular.
Not passing.
No, I don't see anything, and I don't see any kind of bipartisan coming together, even on the things we were hopeful about, including infrastructure.
And healthcare?
I think the Senate will come up with something different and much more modest.
I agree. I think healthcare will get through in a very, very stripped back form, and then no way on tax reform, particularly tied to infrastructure.
I think nothing will happen if the president doesn't agree to an independent commission or a special prosecutor. The Democrats have him over a barrel now. They're not going to get an FBI director or anyone in. This is the most power the Democrats have had since the president won.
All right, great. Ladies, thank you so much.
Thank you.